his voice a little bit, you know, and he's got his throat hurting. He's been trying to do too much, you know, and that's just Bob. So he barely was able to roll over this morning to say, I can't go. He can't hardly talk above a whisper. So we love the Lord and we're carrying on. Amen. And I was reading a book yesterday that actually it was Otto, thank God. But it was saying that in the normal church world, you know, that it was saying how that God's army is the only army that kills its own. And when one would fall, then the other ones would get around it and stab them with their sword. We see so much of that, you know. But by the grace of God, we're not going to do that. You know, we're just going to, you know, love each other. And we're going to help one another. That's what God intended us to do, is to be a strength and a help one to another. And I'm just so grateful that, you know, when we can't go no further, you know, God strengthens us. God isn't like some people, and when we're lying on the floor in a pool of our own blood, they go, up, what's the matter with you? We even read that in the Bible, in Job. You know, up, what's the matter with you? But when we can't go any further, God gives us the strength to, or he carries us. Thank God.
Because he lives,
I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future.
To sleep for a couple of more hours, and I woke right back up with it. So God is giving us joy for sadness, peace for pain, lifted us in the heavenlies, and we will reign with him there. All of his redeemed shall see, hear, and do his will. He's given the peace, so rejoice, and with my love be filled.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Let that first one there speak. Thank you. Until I learn just
my mic on yet. Times when he says, "Be still and know that I am God," we feel like the Pharaoh's army is barreling down on us. The Red Sea's got our back. We just, last thing we want to do is be still. But so many times, if we would just be still, I told one woman yesterday, I said, "You know, there's healing. I know in this hour, God is moving to heal." Now, that don't mean that while things are, you know, the pressure's building, that the crud ain't boiling to the top and the last thing we feel is healed. But God is removing all that. And for God to remove it, he has to bring it all to the top. The last thing that we see is pride or anything in ourselves. Well, I can see, you know, I can see where Pauletta's wrong. But I have trouble seeing where I'm wrong. And I believe God is moving on that. And I felt led of the Lord to tell her, wherever you are, lift your hands and receive your healing. Just lift your hands. Lord, I receive my healing. Father, I readily know I am not perfect. Father God, and only you know how far from it I am. But Lord God, I submit myself under the mighty hand of God. I come to thee, O Lord. Move, Father, save, heal, deliver. Father, only you know where these folks need to be healed. Father, whether it's physically, financially, mentally, spiritually. Father God, but we know that you are moving in this hour to heal us. We don't feel healed. And we don't feel like we're getting ready for the battle ahead. But Lord, I thank you that you are preparing a people for the battle ahead. Father, I thank you, Lord. I like what Gary said, that when they come into the promised land, there were still battles to fight. Father God, this is nowhere. Father, help us to realize this is nowhere to throw down our shield and do away with our sword, take off our armor and say, "Oh, we've made it." Father, teach us how. Teach us, oh Lord, God, teach us about this spiritual warfare, that we would not war after the flesh, but that we would war, O Lord God, with the weapons that are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imagination, and every high thing that would exalt itself against the knowledge of God. Have thine own way, Lord. Have your way in me. Have your way in this service. Lord God, that every word said, every song sung, would be by the unction of the Holy Spirit to the upbuilding and edifying of your church, that we would be prepared. Father, for years your Spirit has been crying out, prepare, prepare. Even, Father God, the word just last week or so was that time is essential. We are running out of time. We need to be prepared. Teach us how to be prepared, O Lord.
I've often said that for a leader, I'm a real good follower. But I've learned that until a person is willing to follow, they will never lead in God's army. Man. God won't allow it. You know, they may try to lead a group of folks or whatever, but they won't be leading the way the Lord would have them to lead. You've got to learn to follow. And I sure wish Bob was here, we could follow him. Well, we're going to follow the Lord, not Bob. Amen. Maybe that's why, you know, it says he maketh me to lie down. And a lot of times he makes the leader lie down so that people don't totally depend on the leader. They depend on the Lord. And we've got in this hour to learn to depend on the Lord. Amen. Of course, we depend on each other. We need each other. And, you know, I'll tell you what, if something smacks my baby toe, I know it. My whole body knows it. Amen. We've got to be more like that because we are the body of Christ. And we've, you know, when something, some person is, they're part of the body of Christ. Amen. And whoever they are, they're when they're hurting, we're hurting. Amen. Or we should be. Amen. God is moving, and I'm so thankful. I just want to be doing what God would have me to do when he would have me to do it. And what the really funniest thing was this morning, I kind of determined I wasn't going to say a word. Oh, praise the Lord.
Well, you made God laugh because you told him your plan.
I know, right? That's right. That's what Bob always says. If you want to make God laugh, tell him your plans. That was my plan. Oh.
Hallelujah.
You know, we were talking about the battle, and every one of us, I think, need to read Ephesians chapter 6 again, you know, and 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through 5. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God. Mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, no matter what that stronghold is. The pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations. So many of us are tormented in our mind, and we don't know to cast down imagination. All we have to do is lift our sword, amen, and cast down imagination and every high thing that would exalt itself against the knowledge of God, and bring into captivity every thought unto the obedience of Christ. And when you study Ephesians chapter 6, which I'm sure Gary is more eloquent in this area than I am, but as I studied it, I noticed it was all about the word. And we have no defense, we have no offense, we have nothing. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word. The sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. It's all about the word.
Amen. Everybody's looking at you, Zach.
Oh. I know this is way off track, but if anybody didn't notice, I moved all of the snack bins over to this side by the computer. So help yourself. I was afraid everybody wouldn't go into the kitchen. It's only like soup beans and stuff in there.
So the Lord has really been speaking to me lately on some things that I believe are crucial for the body in this hour. At least I know they are for me. And one, you know, is about the fact of us giving up sermonizing. Because sermonizing is man's way of preparing to feed a people, but there's a difference of when the Lord feeds us and man feeds us. And not that the Lord's not going to give us snippets or words or pieces, but, you know, that's part of the ministry is, you know, that you traditionally get trained in is you got to have, you know, sermons and speaking and make it all make sense and flow and have teachings that build upon one another. But in this hour, the Lord's drying up the sermonizing. And, you know, I think sometimes we can get confused with throwing out all of the offices or gifts, and I've said that very often, that I don't think, even though the fivefold ministry isn't the completeness, I don't believe the fivefold ministry just evaporates and goes away. I think it gets compounded by the king priest office orders. I believe that again, us prophesying isn't necessarily going to go away, but it's going to change and come into a greater revelation. Us praying and ministering healing isn't going to go away. It's going to expound in the Lord. As we begin to add and walk into these other offices, because we've known, you know, kingship and priesthood isn't a foreign concept, but they're being made manifest in us and becoming realities. So as they become realities, we draw other offices, other orders, other gifts. And I was thinking about that. So I just want to drop that in, because again, as we change the game, so to speak, and step into a new walk in God, we can often get so caught up on destroying everything that was and bringing in something new, that some things are going to carry on with us, but be greater. They're going to be, just as a person is going order to order, it's not a completely new person. It's just a new experience. God has established things that are eternal truths in the heavens that will never go away. But what happens is God reveals the truth to us, and we start to build around it with our imaginations. That song that was sung, those imaginations, the things that we conceptualize, or it wasn't a song, I think Bobby Jean, that was in her prayer or ministry about tearing down those things. And we know that scripture about things that are in the heavens and not natural warfare. But that's what I see, is God's revealed truths in us along the way. And as we get revealed a truth, we try to make sense of it. We try to understand it. We try to bring it forth, so to speak, in our own ways and in our own rituals. And that's the fallacy of just the traditional fivefold ministry, is without that completeness, that kingship and that priesthood, and really hearing from the Lord. And that's what the Lord laid in my heart this morning, was the voice of the Lord, minister to that to my people. And it spoke a lot of things to me that if Lord willing, we'll get into. And I don't plan to be long, but we'll just see, you know, where the Lord takes it. Is in the ministry that we believe we're walking into, we are carrying this torch a step further, a little bit further than where we have been personally, where creation's been. The only place that's been there is Jesus in himself. Because, you know, I believe that Jesus ministered this word. I believe Jesus in his earthly ministry, spiritual ministry before that, his current ministry. You know, Jesus always was this word, because all things were created through the word. So nothing is outside of what Jesus is, was, and always will be. The reality was all around him, people didn't understand it. People didn't get it. They tried to make sense of it. So he tried to teach it in parables to try to make it make sense to creation that was in a lesser place, in a lesser order, in another realm, so to speak. And he would draw some closer to himself and up into realms. And what would happen as he would draw them, even the apostles, they would start to get imaginations wandering. They would start to try to understand what the kingdom's going to be, what this thing that Jesus is talking about is. And Jesus would still say to them and ask them questions. And, you know, I believe that Jesus didn't ask questions because he didn't know an answer. He asked questions to see where people were at and what was going to be the response. And Jesus would begin to ask, and even whenever it came crucifixion time, they didn't understand. They'd say, why do you have to go die? And I'm paraphrasing here, but why are we going to go to a cross and die? I thought we were setting up the kingdom. I thought this was it. Yeah. You know, that's what the apostles would say. And I believe that's us at times. Jesus drops a word in our spirit, reveals something in us, draws it up out of us, and we start to walk right in the midst of it. And we say, well, why are you transitioning me here? Because I thought we were doing it right this way. And all along, the Lord's saying, that was your imagination. That was what you made, not my purpose and my plan. But I believe that that's the order of kings and priests that takes it one step further, that as we begin to teach and preach and prophesy and minister and do all these things, it's going to allow us to stay in a balance with it. Because if we stay under a kingship order, and if it's after the order of Jesus's kingship, that's a kingship that rules and reigns and has authority and governance over all the other things. If we have a priesthood that's after the Lord and after his high priesthood, that keeps our hearts clean and pure, because we are the ones that begin to partake That reconciliation of man unto God, that ministry of reconciliation, that purifying, and we are not that high priest and that lamb that Jesus is, but we partake of that order that begins to keep people back before the heart of God and draws them into that place to where they begin to experience those different rooms, those different dwelling places within the Lord. And it keeps us where we stay balanced in God. Because see, that's what's been missing in all the orders, all the moves. And I'm not just talking about the traditional first, second, third day, because there's moves within moves. There's moves within the Pentecostal realm, within the first day realm, within the kingdom realm, within a third day. However you want to frame it and claim it, there are moves and orders within orders that partake of part of the truth but get things built around them. They begin idol worship. That's what I see it as, is it's not intentionally people worshiping just as we think of Molech or other gods. It's things people are worshiping that they believe and they have seen as kingdom truth, as reconciliation truth, as Melchizedek truth, as any part or parcel of this message or of this word of sonship, of priesthood, of any facet of what Jesus is. They begin to build around that, and they begin to not even just water it down, but begin to implant and minister into people's minds false imaginations. And I was seeing that this morning, that the Lord's voice, as he speaks unto us, is a thing that provides clarity in this day. If we know how to truly hear from the Lord in this thing, and I'm telling you, the Lord is speaking. So if we open up our ears and tune our hearts, we will get guided upon that path that he has taken and that he is, and get carried through this transition and keep our feet on the ground. But if we lose sight of his voice, and if we don't learn to be trained and governed and tutored only by his voice and not another man, and I appreciate what Bobby Jean was saying this morning, because that's been on my heart too this week, about the voice of the Lord, but about this thing is not... It's just so different than what we were taught, even in days gone by, where we're not being governed and tutored by another man. And we've known that, but still people have been drawn to the feet of other men. They have been drawn to their ministry, to sit under that ministry and just sit there. But those days are fading to where we're just going to sit under other people's ministries, and we're going to grow into our own ministry. Because that's really what the corporate expression is in the body of Christ is where we begin to grow. And I'm not saying that other ministries aren't going to nurture us and grow us, but our goal isn't to just be a onlooker and somebody that gets ministered to and somebody that's just sitting back, but we become active in the body under that identity which we are in Christ. Because that's all we have truly. And I was thinking about that. That's part of the thing that I'm talking about is we see somebody minister sonship or kingdom or whatever, again, you want to get into, we begin to try to replicate and copy that. If we start our own ministry, or we think we're inferior to that, so we never try to minister. Because we say, I can never do sonship the way Bill Britton did. Or I can never do kingdom the way Preston Eby did. Or XYZ. I can't write like that. I can't sing like that. I can't teach like that. I'm telling you, that's what's in our imaginations and our carnal mind that's holding this thing back, as I see it. Because God didn't call you to be another man. God didn't call you to act like one of the apostles, to act like another minister of the present day, to be another recreation of something that was. God has called you to be a present living being of who you've been called to be in Christ. That's what's going to begin to heal the body. Because we have all had a gift parted within us, a expression within us that is from the very word that framed and fashioned the world, that was purposed for this time and season to minister to the body where we're at in this very moment. And that'll be the truth next year and the year after, that we are going to keep moving in God to where we become present and fresh and anew, to where we begin to minister to the body out of that which we are. Because see, our natural man, what really holds this thing back isn't just not understanding the doctrine of kingdom. I believe that part of it is God's going to reveal the truths of himself to us, scriptures, and understanding the plan of God. I hold that dear and precious to my heart. But we don't have to understand all the plan of God, because in reality, even those that have come that far as a writer as Preston Eby doesn't understand the fullness of the plan. Because only God can understand the complexity of this plan. What we have to begin to understand and know is, God, what have I been called unto? Again, not just a office or a part in the traditional thing we think of ministry, but God, who am I? What did you birth me to be within you? And see, that's what I believe God is drawing out, because as we have a spiritual seed placed within us, as that thing begins to get nurtured and grows, that is that only way to be transformed into his image is to come into that which he has birthed within us. There's no other way to practice long enough or preach long enough or teach long enough to make it happen. The only way is to tap into that which is within us and begin to allow that to be nurtured and grown and expressed within the body. So I was thinking about that this morning, that God is calling us forth in himself into this hour, into this day, and out of the old. And so that takes a tearing down of strongholds, a burning up of old heavens, however we want to talk about it. It takes that letting go of the old and coming into the new, but that's something that is within us. That's something that we don't get from anywhere outside of us. Not through any other order or teaching or ministry or church or meeting or all the things that we look to move us into God. Now, those things nurture us, but those things aren't the ones accomplishing that which is being done. It's the very living, breathing Spirit of God that is pouring out upon the earth right now. And we all feel that. We see it. We're encountering it. So my biggest, encouragement to you is, if you're feeling this thing, don't get caught up in the inferiority complex. Don't get caught up in the, am I good enough? Am I chosen for this? Am I well enough? My biggest thing is just get in the river and let it carry you where God's going to carry you. Because we don't have to decide and discern. God's just going to do those things. And if we are those that believe we have been called under this word, so be it. And we minister it out to creation. And if you're guessing and wandering, just allow the Lord to carry you upon your journey, because the Lord's going to use you to minister to people where you're at. But stay open to the growth and the expounding of this word, because that's what I see in this hour, is this word is expounding. It's not just staying as a concept or as a doctrine. It's becoming alive in us to where it is beginning to come up out of us and into creation. It is literally transforming us day by day, renewing us. And I was thinking about that, and I've said that last week or the week before, whenever that was, that my life depends on it, and I see that so crystal clear now. Without this word, I would get lost just as any other man would get lost. Now, I don't know if I would go back to doing all the things I would do. I would hope not. But I would be lost just murmuring through this realm, just doing what men do, just going through the rhythms of life, as we would call life in the natural. But this word draws us closer and brings us alive into the reality of Jesus in the earth realm, into the reality of his Spirit being present, drawing all men to himself. So you start to find purpose and meaning and identity in that which we are in him. And that's become such a cliche thing in the church world that I'm telling you, I see so clearly the importance of learning who you are in Christ. Not just finding gifts and ministry and purpose and meaning, because the only real ministry we have is understanding what we were called to do in ourselves. That's when we become secure in it. That's when we become bold in it. We begin to minister it, and we begin to understand it as we tap into our identity. Because God put his thumbprint on every single man and expressed parts of Christ within every single man to where we have a responsibility truly to not be transformed into another man's image, but be transformed into the image of the very living God. That is our responsibility. Because as we become transformed into that image, we become like he is, and creation will begin to see the Lord high and lifted up, his train fill in the temple, and all men will start to be drawn to that. They will see the holy city in the earth realm, the kingdom made manifest, that city upon a hill, and men will begin to say, there is the Christ returned into this realm. Because they're not going to see him naturally in any other physical form. They're going to see him high and mighty, lifted up within a people. They're going to see something different about a people. And the only way to get to that is a genuineness of allowing him to be manifest to where we are who we are in Christ. No longer replicating things and copying things, because that's what religion teaches us to do, to hold up old dead things and try to keep it on display because people want to see it. That's not what we're called to do. We are called to bring forth a new order that man has not yet seen. Because even in Jesus' day, even though he contained it, he wasn't ready to fully release it upon a people. If he was, creation would have been changed right then and there. People would have walked into the fullness. They would have become immortal. They would have become incorruptible. They would have crossed over, as I said last week, all would have been as Enoch and crossed over. But Jesus purposed it to continue on. He purposed us in the Father long ago. We were present in the Father, and now he has called us to come into this realm. So I don't know if we're the ones to minister it in its fullness, but I'm going to minister it in the fullness of now, because there is a greater outpouring for now that's greater than what we've been ministering. So it doesn't matter to me if I minister a word and it draws all people into immortality, but I'm going to preach it like it is. I'm going to believe that it can, because in Jesus, that's a reality and a truth. And it's his business to either do that or not do it. But it's my business and my job in Christ to minister everything that he is within me. To begin to be revealed. And that's the thing, that as we begin to give out of ourselves, it begins to draw more and more out of us the more that we give, the more that we minister. So again, in this day, it's not going to work to just be an onlooker or a partaker. We're going to become active. Whatever that looks like. So again, I'm not saying everybody's going to have to get up and preach and teach and sing, but we're not just going to sit back and receive in this day. Because Melchizedek means to bless. And you can't bless just by sitting back and being blessed. You will be blessed by giving out, and we will receive blessings. However, we the economy of God works like this, and this is one of the first things I learned. The more we give, the more we have. We don't get built up in God just by receiving. We get built up in God and God's economy by giving. And then we receive. And that's what God's calling us to do. Give that which we have, which is, I was thinking about this. You know, we like to joke and make, you know, fun of kind of the burden of this calling, which is okay. I get it. It causes us to go through things. But this word is the biggest blessing we could ever have in life.
Amen.
Because it is life. And I know we can look around and question that at times, because the word sometimes has to slay us and get us into a place where we could be brought into a higher order. But I am telling you, this word is a blessing. It has life in it. It is substance. It is the very thing that feeds me. I don't believe just spiritually, but naturally. I believe it's carrying people past where naturally they could be able to go. I believe it's carrying their bodies, their soul, their desire, their hearts, their wills, their purpose into a greater order than they would without this word. Because again, we could turn our backs on this word and lay down and die. We could just allow us to float through life and doing the things naturally that we would have been purposed to do, but God has called us into a greater order. So I believe God is going to make that so real to us in this hour, where we are going to begin to have visions and have prophecies and things placed within our hearts, and we're going to begin to hear things that are going to keep drawing us into a place of assurance. And if we stay balanced in it under the order of kingship, then God is going to begin to manifest some things within us that we have yearned for and groaned for. But if we stay under an idol worship of that beastly nature, of that corruptible nature that's within us and within every man, because I know that I know it right now that some, and we haven't come as far as we thought in some ways, so if we don't stay under the Lord, this thing will get away from us. If we don't stay governed by the Lord in this day and in this hour, this thing will get a little bit murky at times. It'll get stuff built up around it as every other order and move has. But praise God that I believe, and that's what I was feeling, is if we hear his voice in this hour, he will not allow that to happen. Because this is a pure order. This is a holy order. This is a order that no longer has that corruption that other orders had. There is an order taking place that's pure and holy, that is Jesus himself ministering in a people. So thank God that he keeps us on track and in order. And we have the responsibility to stay before the Lord in this hour. But I just, I wanted to just say that to you. If you're listening, watching, growing in this thing, I don't care if you're first time you've heard us, a thousandth time, been in this thing 10 years, 20 years, just hop right in the river. Amen. And go with us. Because we're all having a fresh new experience in the Lord. We're drawing off of things that the Lord has placed within us. Because I'm here to tell you, the Lord has placed a gift within you since your birth that is going to be used in this day. It's just going to be used in a greater and truer way than it's ever been used before. If you've been a prophet of the Lord, he's going to have us stop prophesying about things that are coming and start prophesying into people's lives and creating change. That's one thing that I see, is there's going to become a creativity to these very gifts that begins to change creation presently and in the now. That's one of the biggest changes, is we're not ministering only about what's to come. We are ministering into the now. We are ministering things and drawing them up out of a people to be used for now. So don't come into this thing desiring to build a ministry that's one day going to develop into some great thing. That's not the purpose of this thing. This purpose is to come into a ministry so that we can have an effect on the body now. And it will continue to grow within us. But I'm telling you, you don't have to understand all the ins and outs to begin to minister this word. Because this word is beyond our comprehension anyways. Amen. It is beyond an understanding of man. Yes. But Jesus is going to... this is what I'm seeing, because we haven't understood where we're going fully. Jesus is going to give us understanding right in the midst of ministering this thing. And that's part of his plan to keep us from getting our hands on it too much. We're going to be prepared and ready and get up and do our next thing, and God's going to reveal it to us and minister it out of us. But that keeps it to where, again, as I started with, we can't sermonize about it. We can't get up and tell you X, Y, Z, here's what we're going to do and here's where we're going. And that's a good thing. Israel didn't know. They had to go year after year and day after day having faith and having some promises, but to wake up each day and be prepared to hopefully that manna's there. That's kind of where we're at. Is each day, each time we get up, each time we come before the Lord, we just expect that we be fed from something new for that day. Yeah. We may not know what it is, what it's going to look like, what it's going to sound like, but we know it's going to be the Lord and it's going to be substance. So as we're getting prepared for October meetings, we don't know what's going to happen. I can't tell you what's going to happen. Now, God may start to reveal some things to me or reveal some things to you that need to be said or done, or we may get some type of confirmation. But I'm telling you, this thing is so complex, he's not just going to lay it all out before someone. And I believe there is going to come a day where we no longer need a leader in the midst of us. That those that have been built up are going to get some burden relief, because there's going to be a mature company of sons in the midst of a meeting that just know who and what they're designed to do and just start doing it. To where that's what I'm seeing, is we get trained in the body, there's going to become a trust within us that I can trust that Phyllis is going to do what Phyllis needs to do in the service, and Rob is, and Gary is, and we're going to say, okay, everyone's hearing from the Lord, and we all know that the Lord, whether it's a do something or don't do something, we're going to obey the Lord in the midst of it. And we're going to begin to be confident that the Lord has prepared something in us. And again, it's not just about preaching that word or teaching that word. It's going to be expressing the Lord in many different ways. So it's going to get beyond the way we think of service, where it's going to become very worship in the midst of God that's going to create that glory to appear. It's going to become worship as we are intrinsically designed to worship. That's the best word to say it. There is a worship that is greater than what we have known. Yeah. that we are designed to be in this realm. See, in worship, in the song of the Lord, each one of us are notes within that song, and we're, as our note is designed to be played and called and hit, we have to allow the Lord to use us and move us so we can become the melody of the Lord in the earth realm, where we can become the song of the Lord in this very realm. But we are missing notes in this hour.
Yes.
We're having some notes being hit, but creation isn't hearing it because there's notes not being played right now. Not just within each one of us, but there are others that have to come into their right place so that we can become that song of the Lord.
Yes.
Because it can't be a partial song. It can't be a missing melody. It can't only have parts of the chorus and be missing other parts of the chorus. But that's what this thing's going to be. It's so complex where I get up, I minister something, and the next person gets up, picks up off of it, and begins to minister that very same word that the Lord is in the very same place, the very same realm, and it begins to have an effect on all of us to where we compound with the Lord and begin to express that which He is in the earth realm. Because it's too much glory for one man to contain. So we need you following online. We need all the people in the room. We need those that are being called into this thing to take their right place in the Lord, understand who you are, and begin to minister with us so that we can bless creation. And hear the voice of the Lord in this thing. Not get our own desires and our own, again, whether it's inferiority complex or the other end, where we think we're the end-all, be-all. We can't be neither. We have to be balanced right in the middle. To truly believe, and I've said this a lot this year, to be bold enough to truly believe that we are called of the Lord unto this place to minister, but then stay humble enough to stay before the voice of the Lord. Because I'm telling you, this ministry isn't just going to be a down and out ministry where we're feeble. This is a powerful, again, if I'm talking about life as Jesus has life, that's a powerful life, is it not? It overcomes death, hell, and the grave. It resurrects the very dead bodies. It overcomes all the spiritual obstacles, everything that's in our way to overcome all those lower and lesser orders to manifest something that is greater than everything else that there is. That's a boldness. That's a power to it. That kingship has authority. Let us begin to speak from that place of authority. Let us begin to have wisdom to understand how to do those things. And that's what I'm seeing, that God is training us day by day and moment by moment and hour by hour to where every time we approach the Lord, we are learning more and more of His ways and of His purpose. I see Him holding our hand through this thing. He is guiding us, taking us onward. Because we can't see where we're going. It's almost as we're walking in the dark and He's guiding us. But I'm telling you, it's going to begin to be less dark and more light. Not just dark in our experience, but dark in our understanding. That's what I see is changing. There's going to become clarity in the heavens. There's going to become a light that He is begin to take place to where we start to understand how to operate in this thing a little bit more, how to minister it out a little bit more. So I'm ministering to those that are following, and I'm believing that I just believe this thing's growing. I really do. I see that. Spiritually, out in the earth realm, I'm encouraging you, if you can make it to meetings, make it to meetings. Not just our October one, but any gathering that's of the Lord and that the Lord has ordained and called, be there. The people need you. That's really the seriousness. Yes.
Not just in this place.
Right. That's what I'm saying, is every place there is that the Lord has truly ordained and called, it is a time of meeting and gathering.
Yes.
A time of preparation. A time of drawing men together to form something and mold something. And I'm telling you, I mean, I've watched plenty of things online, live, recorded. I'm blessed by those things. And they are growing up a people because we don't have the physical time to cover all the ground that's been covered. So thank God for all the recordings and teachings and writings. But I'm telling you, there is a present work at hand that you need to be present for. If the Lord lays that in your heart, He will prepare the way. So take a leap of faith. Join in with us. Again, don't just sit back and watch us do it and receive. Begin to minister into the services, whether you're here in person or not. Begin to minister in. Begin to speak words of life over it, because our bodies need that right now. They need words of life. They need ministry. Our minds have been maybe weary, tired, but I'm telling you, God is building us up in this hour to no longer be from the place of down and out, but to be from the place of an overcomer. So I just bless everyone this morning. Praise God. And I'll pass it off to whoever feels next led.
Harry, do you know that song, Make Me a Great Big Nothing? Let's try to sing that. I don't know what else the Lord's going to do with this. It's been on my heart.
Thank you.
page 12 number. That don't match. Thank you all for bearing with us. Let's go ahead and fuddle through it. But there's a lot of that crushing, you know, and then, you know, it's not going to be fun. And then when God starts to use you, I've seen several people that cry because God is, you know, using them. How is God going to use you if he doesn't use you to help people? And then you get discouraged in that because people are using you. No. You can't let people use you, but God is going to use you to help people. And you've got to learn the balance. Amen?
I was just thinking, Bobby James talking about being used of the Lord. I remember somebody saying this years ago, and I thought it was so interesting. They said, be careful when you pray and ask the Lord to use you, because he will use you up. And I thought that was good. That's true, too. Yeah. What are you wanting to do now?
I said, sing, dance, and tell. Do whatever the Lord tells you to do.
Go ahead. Do the Macarena.
Yeah, right.
Lord, help us all.
Amen.
Where's the rapture when you need it? I just wanted to just say this. It was such a good word, Zach.
Yes.
Shared this morning.
Yes.
The thing the Lord dropped in my spirit this morning was, remove not the old landmarks. And, you know, Bob and I were talking earlier this week and on different occasions that we were talking about the various mentors and giants and leaders that we've had over the years, 30, 40, 50 years, you know, that have been so instrumental in us, you know, getting where we are. And they are the landmarks. And it was interesting, a minister friend that I have, he wrote, and I haven't seen or talked to him in like forever, but he wrote on Facebook this morning that he was giving tribute and honor, and he began to name all the ones that we, you know, you were talking about Bill Britton and Preston Evie and just the various ones, on and on and on, just, I don't know, Kelly Varner, all kinds of these men and women of God that were instrumental in writings or ministering or whatever over the years.
Yes.
You know, and I was talking to Elwin Roach last night, and we just, and that's kind of been in my spirit, you know. These are the landmarks. So I got into the scripture just a little bit ago, and I thought it was interesting. In the book of Deuteronomy and in Proverbs, it says, remove not the old landmarks. And I got into the ancient Hebrew definition of that, and I thought it was really interesting, because the word removes is retreat. Don't retreat. They're there for a reason. These men and women of God have been put in our lives for a time and a season for a reason. And then they have fulfilled whatever purpose God had for them, and they've crossed over. And the thing that I thought was so interesting, that landmark actually comes from an ancient Hebrew word that means to entwine or to wrap around. And we were singing that song, Bobby Jean, out of Isaiah, They That Wait Upon the Lord. That word weight literally means to entwine yourself. And I thought so much about how that we've come to, we preach so much about the feast of the Lord. And I, you guys know I'm a firm believer in all that.
Oh,
Passover,
yes.
Pentecost, tabernacle, yes. And so forth. And the thing of it is, we've kind of preached almost that the third day, the greatest feast, the Feast of Tabernacles, is kind of the ultimate end all. And it isn't. Because the scripture says after the feast, meaning there's something going on afterwards. And I begin to go over there to the book of Joshua, as Zach was sharing, and he said some things that really hit my spirit. It was so good. In the book of Joshua, when they were getting ready to cross over, it says after 3 days, there's something beyond the third day. And he said, to sanctify yourselves and get ready, because there's about to be a manifestation you've never witnessed before. Now, King James puts it this way. He said, you have not passed this way before. You've not gone there. And I believe we're on the verge of experiencing a word, a manifestation, whatever. We can give all these terminologies we want to, but I believe there's going to be a reality of manifesting some things that heretofore we've not seen or witnessed. There's going to be such a breakthrough in the heavens, because we've not gone this way before. And, you know, it's like this. It's necessary. I was thinking about how that we were singing the worship before we got started this morning. As we approach this after the third day, as we approach after this feast, it is so necessary that we wait, entwine ourselves with the Lord.
Amen.
Whether it be a song, whether it be a word, whether it be anything, no matter, and not just in a service, but our everyday life.
Amen.
Everyday life, everything about us, because, you know, I appreciate what Zach had said earlier about when we come to a maturity where we know our place in God to manifest or to minister out of that place. The children of Israel, all had to sanctify themselves. That meant to be set apart. They all had to do that. You couldn't walk in this day unless you were sanctified. Then it said, some of them, meaning the priests of the Lord, they had to walk into Jordan to hold it back. And, you know, that's the ones, the leaders, as it were,
yeah,
are the last ones now. That which was first is now last, because we're about to walk into a full manifestation we've never witnessed before. I appreciate what Zach said, because I agree so much with that, because the Lord dealt with me years ago. I don't know. Here's what I believe. I believe there is a company of people. I don't know who they are, where they are. I believe, just on top of my head, I believe they're walking the earth today. But I believe there's a generation that will walk in the fullness of this thing. Whether or not I'm one doesn't change the truth.
Amen.
Whether or not I'm one doesn't mean one thing one way or the other. I'll fulfill whatever God has for me. But I'm like David. I once was young and now I'm old. And I've never seen the righteous forsaken nor a seed begging bread.
Amen.
In other words, I don't know if I'm one, but it doesn't change the truth one iota.
Right.
There's a people that'll walk in them. And here's the beauty. Here's the beauty of it. Since there is only one body, that means, Zach, if you're one of the ones that God's called to walk into the manifestation, you and Sarah are going to walk in and manifest His fullness, that's a good thing. I'm going to encourage you, push you up. I'm going to strengthen you. You know why? Because I'm part of Him.
Yes.
And if He makes it, that means I make it.
Yes.
If you make it, I make it. This isn't a race where me and Zach's
right.
trying to see who's first.
Right. Amen.
Or me and Bob, or me and Bob.
Right.
This is not a race where we're trying to get ahead of somebody.
Right.
This is one where we bear you one another's burden, lift each other up,
yes.
strengthen. Because we don't know the fullness of God in this day that we're in. All we know is we're in this together. And if I can encourage you and lift you up, and you're appointed by the Father before the foundation of the world to walk in this fullness, that means I get to walk in with you.
Amen.
I'll be on your coattail, but I'll be coming in. And that's what this is about. Amen.
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 Tag, you're it.
Well, as I always say, are all hearts clear? Did you do what God wanted you to do this morning? Did you sing, dance, and tell? Did you, if you haven't given your heart to the Lord, now is a good time. All you have to do is, there's an old song we used to sing, Into My Heart, as children in Sunday school. Into my heart, into my heart, please come into my heart, Lord Jesus, come in to of righteousness, the planting of the Lord. Amen. I love you this morning. God richly bless you is our prayer. We appreciate all of you praying and supporting Gary and Paula and me and Bob, and we appreciate Zach. All of us appreciate your prayers, and trust me, we all need them. And not just Bob, we all need them. We love you, and God bless you. All right. God bless you. Have a great week.